Come on, BBC, come on over here.
Oh Lord, my God.
When I in awesome wonder consider all the worlds thy hands have made, I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy path throughout the universe display. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. And when I think God his Son not sparing sent him to die, I scarce can take it in that on the cross my burden gladly bearing, he bled and died to take away my sin. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great. And Christ shall come with shout of acclamation and take me home. What joy shall fill my heart? Then I shall bow in humble adoration and then proclaim, my God, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great. great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Amen, amen, amen.
Some of you just heard that song, How Great Thou Art, and we know that God is great. One of the reasons why we know that God is great is because, first of all, God made this beautiful day that we're enjoying right now.
Amen.
This beautiful day that we're enjoying is a day that God has made, and the Bible says that we should rejoice and be glad in it. And the only way that we can truly rejoice and be glad in the day that God has made is that we know the God who has made this beautiful day that we're enjoying right now. The Bible lets us know that every one of us here knows that there's a God. There's not one single person who can deny credibly that there is a God who exists, that there is a God who's made everything that we're enjoying right now, that there is a God who actually gives us a conscience so that we can know even within our own hearts the difference between right and wrong. That comes from somewhere. It's not just from society. It's not just because your mom told you, your dad told you. There is a God who even planted within your heart his law so that you'd know the difference between right and wrong. The Bible lets us know that God has made us and not we ourselves. And because God has made us, we owe God our obedience.
Amen.
We owe God our honor. We owe God glory because God is the one who has made everything that we have in this beautiful world today. But in spite of all the beauty that God has made, there's also a lot of hurt. There's a lot of heartache. There's a lot of hopelessness. There's a lot of people who walk around this city in sadness and despair. And the reason why we walk away with sadness and despair is because we have first walked away from God, who is our loving and gracious creator. The Bible lets us know that even within our hearts, as I said before, that we know that there's a difference between right and wrong. There's a difference between what's beautiful and what's ugly. And we know that a lot of what we see in our city even today is ugly. Nobody has to tell you that a lot of what we've seen even in the news in the past couple of days has been ugly. But there is a God who rules over everything. There's a God who's created us for himself, for his glory, for his pleasure. And as I said, what we've done is we've walked away, we've turned away from this God who exists. I want to share with you a passage of scripture that many of you might know, many of you might have heard before. But I want to make sure that you understand the point of this parable that Jesus gave. This parable is found in the book of Luke, in Luke chapter 15. In Luke chapter 15, it talks about a story about two sons. There were two sons, both sons of the same father, and one of the sons asked his father if he could have his portion of the inheritance so that he could do what he wanted with it. Let me ask you a question. When do you get an inheritance from your parents? When is the will carried out? It's after the parents are what? Somebody say it.
Dead.
After the parents are dead. Basically, this one son was wishing that his father was dead so that he could do what he wanted with the money that he thought belonged to him. He wished his father were dead. And you know what? This is a picture of exactly how we are with God. What we desire to do is we desire to take God's good earth. We desire to take the food that God has given to us. We desire to take the breath that God gives us to breathe. And we want to do whatever we want with it. We live life as if God does not exist. But the Bible lets us know that every one of us knows that God exists. In the book of Psalms, in chapter 14 and verse 1, Psalm 14, verse 1, it says this, that the fool says in his heart that there is no God. The fool says in his heart that there is no God. When the Bible talks about the word for fool, it's not talking about a person who's just ignorant. It's not talking about a person who's naive. It's talking about a person who has information and he acts contrary to the information that he knows. Everybody knows that God exists, but the fool says in his heart, there's no God. I don't have anything to worry about. I can live life the way that I want to live without any consequences. And if you live that way, the Bible says you're a fool. You're living as if the information that you know exists doesn't exist. You're acting like you can walk out in this beautiful weather, see the sun shining on you. We had the rain that fell on us earlier today. Like all of this just came out of nowhere. If I looked at the ships that are behind me right now, and I tried to convince you that, you know what, I was in a junkyard and that just blew up and happened. Boom, there it is. Ships ready to ride on the ocean. Nobody would believe me. They'd tell me I was a fool for believing that. And many of us believe, somehow we try to convince ourselves, that everything that we have around us, boom, just happened. And then we act like billions and billions of years answers the question. People say, well, if you had enough time, that nothing can produce everything. What kind of fool believes that? It's a fairy tale. It is a fairy tale to believe that all of this came out of nothing. The Bible says the fool says in his heart that there is no God. There is a God. And one day we will have to answer to this God. And God has declared to men everywhere that all men should repent. Repent is a word that means to turn around, to stop walking your own way. Stop living life for yourself. Stop living life for your own glory, for your own pleasure, acting as if God doesn't exist. The Bible says that we need to turn around and turn towards Him. And what God has done, because He's loving, because He's kind, is that He does not want you to perish in your sins. The Bible lets us know that every one of us is a sinner. You may act like that's an archaic word. We don't like to use the word sin anymore, except like for something really horrible, like when somebody blows themselves up. Oh, that's evil. But then we don't want to call ourselves evil. When we know that we've lied, when we know that we've stolen things before, when some of you even right here are sleeping with somebody that you're not even married to, some of you are trying to redefine marriage as something that the Bible says that it's not, and acting as if it's okay. You don't get to define marriage. That's God's institution. We don't get to redefine marriage the way that we want to. We don't get to redefine life the way that we want to. But what we do is we act as if God's not there and I can do what I want. No consequences. Nobody's got to have nobody to answer to. The Bible lets us know that we will answer to God one day. And everybody who's hearing my voice right now, you know that within your heart.
Amen.
You know it's true. You know that one day you're going to have to answer to God, because your own conscience bears witness. There's some things that you've done, I don't even have to remind you, there's some things that you feel guilty for. There's some things that you can look back on your life and you say, you know what, I wish I never did that. There's some of us that live with regret, live with things that just kind of weigh heavy on us. Where do you think that comes from? How are you going to relieve yourself of that? And here's the big question, is how are you going to answer before God when one day you stand before Him? Every one of us, as I said, will stand before God one day and have to give an account for our sins and our transgressions against Him. Every one of us will have to do that. And the question that I have for you, my friends, and we're out here because we love you, because we love people, we love God, we don't want to see you perish in your sins. And the question I have for you today is this: how are you, as a person who has violated the commands of God, who has acted as if God doesn't exist and lived life for yourself, how are we as guilty people, how are you as a guilty person going to stand before God and be declared innocent? When you stand before God, and one day all of us will, when you stand before God on that final day when you take your last breath, when you stand before God, will you be declared innocent or guilty of breaking His laws? You know what the answer is? I don't even have to tell you what the answer is. The answer is that every one of us would be declared guilty. And you know what that means? That means that we all deserve judgment. We all deserve a punishment. And that punishment that has been meted out by God, because God is so infinitely holy, is an eternity in hell. And that's why we're out here, because we don't want people to suffer an eternity in hell.
Amen.
Listen to me, people. Hell is forever. It's not purgatory. There's no such thing as purgatory, where you just kind of serve your time for a few years and then you get let out. Hell is forever. And we're out here because we want to warn people of the judgment to come. We don't want to see you suffer for an eternity in hell. You don't have to. And the reason why you don't have to is because there has come one, there's the only one, who ever walked the face of this earth who could actually give God what He's worthy of. The Bible says this. The Bible says that the greatest commandments, the first two are different, but the greatest commandments, Jesus says, He says, what are the greatest commandments? The greatest commandments, he says, the first one is this, the greatest commandment, to love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, with all your strength. So that's the first and greatest commandment. How many of us have ever done that perfectly? You know what the answer is? Nobody. Nobody. How many of us have loved our neighbor perfectly? He says the second greatest commandment says this, to love your neighbor as yourself. How many of you have done that perfectly? Nobody. Nobody. So when you stand before God on, even on those two, the greatest commandments, we're guilty. We're guilty. And because we're guilty, we deserve punishment. Not one of us can give God a good reason to let us into his perfect kingdom. Not one of us can give God a good reason to let us into his heaven, which he's created in beauty and glory for himself. Why would God let you in? The only answer, the only solution to that dilemma is found in Jesus Christ. In 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 21, 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 21, it says that he, God, made him, Jesus Christ, to be sin for us, so that we might become the righteousness of God in him. God deserves righteousness. God deserves obedience, and not one of us could give it to him. The only person who walked this earth who could give God perfect obedience was Jesus Christ. The only sinless one, who walked this earth, gave God perfect obedience. And because of his righteousness, the Bible says that we can be substituted for, that Jesus Christ will be our substitute. Stand in your place. Live the righteous life that you couldn't live. And what he did was he died, he was crucified. Some of you have seen the Passion of the Christ. There's a bloody death. There's a brutal death. There's a death that even Roman citizens couldn't endure because of their citizenship. It was a death that they gave to slaves and the worst criminals of society. And here you have God's only beloved Son who came to suffer the most brutal death imagined. And why did he do that? He did that for you. He did that for everyone who would believe and trust in him. For everyone who would believe and trust in him, everybody who would repent of their sins and fall on their knees before an almighty God, that his life would count for yours, that his death would count for yours, and that you could be set free. And I want to ask you, my friends, what would prevent you from receiving the good gift of Jesus Christ? What would prevent you from doing that today? Is there any sin that you're willing to hold on to in defiance against God and suffer for an eternity in hell because you love your sin so much? What prevents you from bowing the knee to Jesus Christ? The Bible says this, that there is only one sacrifice for sins. And if you walk away and you ignore Jesus Christ, there is no sacrifice left for your sins, but the awaiting of the fury of his wrath. And this is what we want to try to warn our friends about here today, that there is a fury coming. That there was a judgment coming. If I saw you in a building and the building was burning and I never warned you about it, I would not be a loving person. If I saw you going the wrong way down a one-way street and you're about to be struck by a vehicle and I didn't say, hey, get out the way, I would not be a loving person. And if I know that the wrath of God hangs over the sons of disobedience and I do not warn you to tell you that there is the wrath coming to get out of the way, I would not be a loving person. I would not love you. I would not care about you. But the Bible lets us know that there is a way out, and we do care about you. And we want to let you know about that way out. And the only path that God has made for us to be saved is Jesus Christ. Acts chapter 4, verse 12, said that there is no other name under heaven given among men by which we must be saved. If you're going to be saved, it must be through Jesus Christ. There is no other way to be saved except through Jesus Christ. Nobody else died and rose again for your sins. Nobody else did that. Only Jesus Christ died and rose again for your sins. Only Jesus Christ did that. Everybody else's grave, you can go and visit them today. Jesus Christ's grave is empty because he rose and defeated death. He can defeat death for you if you would turn and trust in Jesus Christ.
Amen.
So I pray for you, dear friends, that you would turn to the only one that can bring you life. I pray for you, dear friends, that you turn to the only one who can bring you hope. We might have hope in this life, but if we only have hope in this life, the Bible says that we're of all men the most to be pitied. We're the most miserable people on earth. And there's some of you that only have hope in this life. How long do you think you're going to live? How long? 50, 60, 70, 80? Some of us maybe 90 years? I'm telling people this week my father died at 56 and the year 2000. He died at 56 of a heart attack right after he played a game of basketball. He was in great shape. He didn't know he was going to die that day when he walked out to work that morning. None of you know when your last day is going to be. And the Bible says this: what would it profit a man if he gained the whole world and lost his soul? What would it profit a man if he gained the whole world and lost his soul? What are you living for? Jesus Christ is the only way. He's the way, the truth, and the life. And no man comes to the Father except through him. There's a sacrifice. There's a hymn that says, there is a fountain filled with blood, drawn from Emmanuel's veins. And sinners plunge beneath that flood, lose all of their guilty stains. And we pray that you would be free from your guilt, free from your sin, and be able to stand before God on that last day and say, I'm standing here not because I have a righteousness of my own, but because I have the righteousness of another, that somebody has come to be my substitute, that somebody stands in my place, has been condemned for me, and he gives me his righteousness so that I might have life. You only have one entrance in, and it's through the door, and it's through Jesus Christ. We have some friends around here. They're in the t-shirts. We'd love to talk to you, love to pray for you. We'd love to see you be reconciled to God. We beg you on behalf of God to be reconciled to him. God bless you. We're here from Baltimore Bible Church. We love you. We'll pray for you. God bless you.
Amen. Amen.